very happy to talk here today about biological clocks. The title of my talks is Control of Our Biological Rhythms. And this picture illustrates that at the very beginning of evolution, very simple organisms developed and they lived at the surface of the sea. And they had to protect themselves against the dangerous UV radiation. Now, in order to escape from the UV radiation, they had to go to the deeper sea levels to anticipate the rise of the sun. And this possibility for the organisms to anticipate to the rise of the sun required the development of an endogenous biological clock. By developing an endogenous biological clock, you can anticipate changes that are expected to come. Now, from the time onwards, all organisms on Earth have been faced with the changes in the environment. This is a picture of the Earth taken from the Apollo moon flight, and you can see that the Earth is always illuminated on one side and is dark on the other side. And since beginning of evolution, all organisms had to deal with these changes in the environment, and all organisms developed endogenous biological clocks. And in fact, if you look at the genetic structure, at the deeper structure of our clock, there are large similarities with the very primitive clocks that have evolved 4 billion years ago in these single-cell organisms. So also humans have a large number of 24-hour rhythms in their bodies. And for instance, we show 24-hour rhythms in the activity of brain nuclei. We also show 24-hour rhythms in our hormone levels. And if you measure carefully the cortisol levels in our blood, you can see, for instance, that cortisol levels already rise before we wake up in the morning to prepare us for the day, because cortisol is required for activity. So this is an example of how also these changes help us and prepare us for changes that are allowed to come. Cognitive functions show 24-hour rhythms, and also, for instance, performance and reaction time shows 24-hour rhythms. And to give you an example, our performance during the night is similar as our performance during the day after 2 glasses of wine. So this is about the difference in our performance that we don't subjectively experience, but which is clearly there, and which is important if we start to think about shift work. Well, there are a great number of other rhythms that are present in our body. And in our research, we measure these rhythms and we tried to identify the mechanisms behind it. Now, we can measure these rhythms very easily. If we have a mouse in a cage and we give the mouse a running wheel, then it starts to run in the wheel and we don't know why it is doing it, but all mammals do it. If you expose them to wheels, they start to run in it. And you can then connect this to a setup, to a computer, and you can record the rhythms. Now, mice are nocturnal, so the behavioral activity of the mice is mostly confined to the night. And I can show you here is 12 hours of light, 12 hours of darkness, and the days are plotted beneath one another, and the mice is mostly active during the night. But if you look really carefully, you can see that the mice starts the activity every day slightly before dark onset. Yeah? So this is already indicating that the animal knows subconsciously that there is the other phase of the cycle that is about to come. From here onwards, the animal is released in constant darkness. And what we see now is that the animal remains rhythmic. This is the first conclusion. Rhythm remains. So apparently this rhythm is driven by something from within the animal. But the period is now slightly different from 24 hours, it's shorter. And this is typical for all nocturnal animals. So in all nocturnal animals, the periods are shorter than 24 hours and they start a little bit earlier every day. But please note the incredible precision of this rhythm. There is a variability from day to day in the order of several minutes. Now, suppose you have to guess the time and you haven't looked at your watch for several hours, you're easily off by half an hour or more. And if you haven't looked at your watch for a day, you are off even much more. But in the meantime, our biological rhythms have continued with a very clear precision. And this is also why we feel the change from wintertime to summertime, from summertime to wintertime. It's a change of only 1 hour. It's not dangerous, it's not harmful, as it's sometimes mentioned in the press, but you do feel it, because it is, an hour is a large shift as compared to our precision. So in nocturnal animals, period is shorter than 24 hours, and biological rhythms are endogenous, produced within the organism. In humans and in all other diurnal species, rhythms are often longer than 24 hours. And this is an experiment, a very old experiment, in which a human subject has isolated himself and sleep and wake was recorded. So here is the day, here is the night. Black is period of awakening and yellow is sleep. And the individual is allowed to live according to his own preference. And what you see then is that the human being starts activity a little bit later every day and shifts to later times. And this is what we tend to do in the weekend. In the weekend, when we are not forced to wake up in the morning, we tend to shift to later sleeping times and later wake-up times. And especially adolescents, and I don't go in much detail, but especially adolescents have a very long free-running period by themselves. So especially adolescents have a tendency to go to bed late and to wake up late if they are allowed to. So this is a biological phenomenon, but also we have this a little bit, and Monday morning is usually the most difficult morning of the week. So the biological clocks are sensitive to light, and they are sensitive to light in a very particular way. The sensitivity to light depends on the time of the day at which light is perceived. And this is for nocturnal and diurnal animals alike. And this is illustrated as follows. Here you see a mouse, again, released in constant darkness. And now the period is a little bit shorter than 24 hours. And if we expose the mouse to 15 minutes of light at the end of the night, so to speak, the clock is speeded up. It is phase advanced, and the animal starts the activity earlier. Whereas if the animal sees the light at the beginning of the night or the end of the day, the clock is delayed and the rhythm is shifted to later times. And this is very relevant for humans, and especially for adolescents or evening type people, because we have continuously problems to speed up our clock. So what we should do is expose ourselves to light in the early morning. And what we should prevent is to expose our clocks to light in the evening, as you do if you are doing video games or watching television or having bright lights on. Then in fact you further delay your clock and you will have more problem getting up the next day. Now for so far, this was a kind of black box analysis in which I indicated some basic attributes of this biological clock, or this circadian system, as it's also called. From circa is about, and circadian, circa a day, circadian system. And from now, I want to go into the system, and I want to ask the question, at what level of organization are the different attributes of the system formed? And a usual scheme that is made is that you can think of the lowest level of organization as the gene together form the functioning of the cell together form networks, form a network, networks interact, form networks of networks, and then finally, there is this function that you can also analyze by watching the behavior or by doing particular measurements from an animal. So at what level of organization these attributes of the clock are being formed? Now, this is a slice of a mouse brain. And here I want to indicate that the biological clock has actually a very clear localized position within the brain. This is the cortex, the upper layer of the clock. The nerve cells are stained with a pink color, and the nerve fibers are stained in blue. And here at the bottom of the brain, you see the place where the optic fibers, the nerves that come from your eyes, where they cross. And if you zoom in at this area of the brain, then you see embedded in the optic chiasm a population of neurons. It's 10,000 neurons of each on each side. And these cells are called the suprachiasmatic nuclei, or nucleus, and they function as a biological clock. It is only 500 micrometers, so the thickness of a nail, this is. So it's a very small structure, and these cells have the genetic capacity to produce rhythms. And we can visualize that. We can connect the genes of the clock to a substance that fireflies produce. So this is luciferase, it is illuminating. And if we now connect the genes of the clock to this illuminating substance, we can actually view the activity of the genes. And here I show you one of our recordings, and we go over a few days. And now I get instructions. Thank you. Yeah, and here we see the two parts of the clock, left and right. And you see here's day one. The genes are less active as a population, and now they are more active as a population. So day two, and now we can go to day three. So these cells, if they are brought in isolation, they continue to produce as a group a rhythm of roughly 24 hours. Now our question is now, what are the individual cells doing? Can we also record the activity patterns of individual cells? And we as an electrophysiology group are specialized in recording nerve impulses, electrical signals that are generated by the cells. And these are important signals because nerve cells communicate not by the release of genes, but they communicate with one another by sending electrical signals to one another. So this is a recording electrode. We can put a recording electrode close to a nerve cell, or we can even impale the nerve cell, and we can measure the electrical activity of a group of cells. So here you see the electrical activity that is now spontaneously generated in these isolated nerve cells, and we can count these nerve cells, and we can look at their profile. And now we can also look at the profile of individual cells. And the profile of individual cells is a little bit surprising, or it was when we discovered it. So here is the frequency of the pulses, and here is the time. Here it's 12 hours light and 12 hours of darkness. And this is the activity profile of an individual cell. And here I summarize a series of experiments that we did. And we found that the secondary cell is active at a different time, and a third cell, again, different at a different time. So that together, these cells are actually responsible for this 24-hour wave that is produced in the biological clock and transmitted to the remaining of the brain. So it's the coordinated activity of many cells that produces this rhythm. So we have here a network of clocks, so to speak. So the individual cells generate rhythms, but together they form a network of clocks. And now we can question, what is the advantage now of this complex network, of this network in which different elements are all able to produce 24-hour rhythms, but they do so slightly out of phase. Now, properties of networks and properties of this network is that there is a certain balance achieved now between robustness of the clock as a whole and flexibility on the other hand. And I will start to give you an example of robustness. Our clocks are not designed for shift work and for traveling between time zones. They are designed to adapt to small changes or to show small responses to light, to accommodate to the light-dark cycle, but they are not designed to immediately shift by 6 hours or more in order to adjust to a different time zone. And this is important in our modern life because of course, we expose ourselves a lot to changes in time zone. For instance, if we travel here from Amsterdam to New York, we are exposing ourselves to a delay of the light-dark cycle of about 6 hours. So it's an acute shift in the environment of about 6 hours. This is a protocol that we exposed the animals to in order to investigate what happens in their clock. So here is 6 hours of darkness, 12 hours of light, 6 hours of darkness, and then the next day it continues. So this is 12 hours of darkness, 12 hours of light. And then the animal is exposed to a 6 hour delay of the light-dark cycle, as if the mice is flying from Amsterdam to New York. And then we investigate what happens in the clock of the animal. And what we see then is that there are suddenly two populations of cells that are showing up. Two populations of cells, instead of finding a single peak in electrical activity in the clock, we find one very small peak that is fully shifted and in line with the new time zone, whereas there is another component in the clock that is not shifted at all. So this is the first day after the jet lag. There's two components, one shifted, one unshifted. And at day three, there's still two populations that are visible, one shifted, one unshifted, and only at day six, this population is shifted over and is now fully synchronized with the shifted population. So there is a group of cells here in the clock that produces inertia, that produces robustness, and it only shifts to the new cycle when it has been exposed to the new cycle for enough days, and only then it shifts. Now, in humans, it is a similar situation. It is a behavioral activity pattern of a human being exposed to a shift. So here it's dark, 12 hours of light and darkness again. Human being is adjusted to that. Now it's going to shift, delay of 6 hours, and we can see that it needs at least 6 days to be completely adjusted to the new cycle. Now this is important because, as I said before, our performance during the night is similar as our performance during the day after two glasses of wine. So suppose that as a surgeon, you suddenly have to wake up in the night and perform a difficult surgery. Well, you don't want your surgeon to do this experiment, during the day after having two glasses of wine. But this is actually what happens if it has to be done in the night. Also, pilots and people who are working at nuclear plants really have to take care that they are very alert during the night. And if you look at the time at which major accidents have happened, it is nearly always, if not always, it was based on human mistakes made during the night. Nearly all of them are made during the night. So it is very important to understand how we can overcome robustness in the circadian system, or how to deal with it optimally to prevent those mistakes. So the network shows robustness on the one hand, but the network also shows adaptability, and I will give an example of the adaptability. One example is that the biological clock that takes care of our 24-hour rhythms also takes care of seasonal rhythms. And seasonal rhythms occur, for instance, in the length of the day. The length of the day changes very much, and this is perceived by animals, and this information is transmitted to the same structure of the brain. So this is a picture of a gray wolf in the summer. Its appearance is gray, and this is a picture of the same gray wolf in the winter, and the fur is now white. And you could expect that this is a response to the low temperature, and that the low temperature is inducing the changes in the fur, but it is not. And in the laboratory, we can mimic this completely by putting hamsters, for instance, either on a long day and a short night, or on a short day and a long night with respect to the light-dark regime. Both animals were kept on 21 degrees, but they fully develop these seasonal adaptations. So in the Netherlands, the changes in day length are quite large. We have now about 16 hours of darkness and 8 hours of light. And in the summer, we have very short nights and very long days. And actually, at this moment, we are about, we are roughly at the longest or shortest day of the year and the longest night of the year. So these changes in day length are also picked up by the eye, transmitted to the same structure. So it's one and the same structure in the brain that processes information related to the Earth's rotation around the sun and related to the Earth's rotation around the axis. So how is it dealing with this information? Well, if an animal is kept in a 12-12 light-dark cycle, we have seen that there is a certain phase dispersal among the clock cells. But if an animal is kept on a short day and a long night, as in the winter, What we find is that the synchronization among the neurons becomes much more narrow. They are more fully synchronized, and the population signal is now changed. And the width of the activity pattern here is now corresponding with the length of the day. So we have now created an internal signal, in the brain, that is corresponding with the external length of the day. And in the summer, this desynchronization increases, and as a consequence, we get very shallow rhythms. But again, the length of the activity period is now corresponding with the length of the day. So the adjustment to the season requires a network. It is something that cannot be done at the single cell level. If the synchronization among the neuron changes, the properties of the network also change. And I'll give you an example. If the cells are fully synchronized, as in short days, and we investigate the response to a light pulse, so here in animals in a light-dark cycle, it's now released in constant darkness, and here we give a light pulse, and we see there is a big phase shift induced. However, if an animal is on a long day, the clock is desynchronized, we release it in constant darkness and we give a light pulse, there is no phase shift induced. So the properties of the clock are now also changing in accordance with the changes that we see at the cellular level. And this is surprising. And this is surprising for the following reason, and it's very important for the complexity issue to explain this a little bit. The amplitude of the rhythm is very high when cells are fully synchronized. So in short days, we have high amplitude rhythms. But the amplitude of the rhythms are low if the cells are not very much synchronized. We have low amplitude rhythms at a population level. Now, there is a very general law applicable to nearly all systems and certainly to all individual cells that high amplitude rhythms are difficult to shift, are robust, and that low amplitude rhythms are easy to shift, are very flexible. But what we found is actually the opposite. And we can explain that. So if we have a network of fully synchronized clocks, and we give this network a light pulse, then all the clock cells see the light pulse at the same phase, and they will all show a consistent phase shift, leading to a large shift of the population. However, if we have a desynchronized population of cells, and we give a light pulse, then all the cells see the light pulse at a different phase of their cycle. They all shift in different directions, and the net shift is very small, as you can see here. So a synchronized population shifts more. And what's important now is that the properties of the network have now become opposite to the properties of the elements. So the elements show large shifts if their amplitudes are small. The population show large shifts if the amplitude is high. So this is also a warning that you cannot simply deduce the capacities from the population from the capacity of the elements. It may be completely opposite. Now there is a medical aspect to this, or medical relevance to this, and I want to show that and almost finish with that. And that is aging. What you see in aging, in aged people, is that their amplitude of their rhythms get very poor. Aged people sleep bad at the night. I think I have the number here. And they fall asleep often during the day. So there is reduced alertness here and sleeping problems during the night. And I think there are sleep disorders in more than 50% of the elderly is the estimation. And there is a clear lack of daytime alertness. Now, after we found by our very fundamental research that in long summer days the cells desynchronize, that the rhythms get very poor, and that the phase shifting response is very low, we thought this is very similar to what you actually see in aged people. Is it maybe possible that aging of the clock and the age-related disturbances in our 24-hour rhythms are maybe also a consequence of a lack of a functioning of the network? So we started to investigate that. Oh yeah, first I would like to show that aging of biological system is a very biological general phenomenon. Even in a snail, you see that it is very showing robust rhythms in young age. If it's 9 months, it's middle-aged, it goes down, it gets older, and here it's a really old snail. There's hardly any rhythm left. So this is not only something in humans, it's a general phenomenon. So there is a decline in rhythmicity, and there is also a reduction in the ability to phase shift. And for humans, that has as a consequence that they get difficulty to work in shift work. And that is actually something that already starts at the age of 55 years old. Then people already experience a diminished capacity to work in shift works. So our hypothesis was that maybe in aging, what happens is that the cells become desynchronized, and that explains at the same time the reduction in their rhythm amplitude, their sleeping problems, and also the disability to work in shifts. And well, this is also summarizing 2 years of research, because indeed we confirmed that this is the case, and we just published this. And the important implication is also that treatment should now be aimed at restoring a network function. Treatment should not be aimed at restoring genetic function or a cellular function. A treatment should be aimed at restoring the functioning of the network. Okay, and then the very last aspect I want to mention is the role of exercise, because you may wonder, how can we improve our clocks? And this is very recent line of research from us. And we have performed recordings in the biological clocks. And we have videotaped animals. And we have kept track of the moments when they were active and when they were not active. And I want to show you here, this is a 2-day recording of the biological clock. These are the electrical impulses that are generated by the clock. But now in black, we have plotted all the moments that the animal is active. And in gray, all the moments that the animal is not active. And we've plotted them separately. So it's one recording. Yeah, it's the same recording, same place. But we have just given the moments of activity and inactivity a different color. Now, as you have a nocturnal animal, of course, most activity is in the night. So here's a lot of black. And here in the day, there is a lot of rest, so here's a lot of gray. But now imagine, if an animal has a very beautiful activity rhythm, is a good sleeper, and is very active and energetic during the day, then what happens, then you go here nearly exclusively to the red line. There's little resting during the day, there's a lot of activity during the day, so you go to this level. And now if it's a good sleeper, you go to the blue line during the night, and you get only points at this area. So, if the animal in its behavior is showing very beautiful rhythms, as a consequence, the biological clock will go to its deepest level during the night and to its upper level during the day. So the amplitude of the rhythm of the clock is now not amplified, but optimized by having activity at the proper phase of the cycle. Whereas if an animal is subjected to a jet lag, or if we imitate a shift work protocol, and the animal is actually active at the opposite phases of the clock, then as a consequence, the activity level of the clock the rhythm will diminish. And this has some consequence for our complexity thinking, because we notice now that the biological clock, which is in itself capable of producing rhythms, produces a behavior-activity rhythm, but that the behavior-activity rhythm in itself feeds back to the clock. And we get here, despite the two minuses, this is a positive feedback loop in which the two amplify one another. Yeah? There's an amplification here. So we see here that the clock also, while being a network itself, is part of a larger network. So coming back to this question, at what level are attributes of the clock formed? And I showed you this figure in the beginning. We have now several examples. And we can conclude that rhythm generation is produced in individual cells on the basis of the genetic constitution of these cells. These cells are able to produce, so to speak, rudimentary rhythms. But to synchronize to the Lydark cycle, to show robustness, to show seasonal adaptation, to show precision, to explain what happens during aging, to explain the beneficial influence of exercise, we have to go with our explanations to the network level. And I thought this is a very important message here, because much of the research in life science is actually very genetic at the moment, of course, because we have so much new discoveries in the genes. But I think the time is ripe now to realize that also many attributes are formed at higher levels of organizations and are formed at network levels. So, and also diseases may be a consequence, likewise, of failure at the network level. So I think we should pay more attention to that. And the conclusion of my talk is therefore that many properties in a biological systems are formed at higher levels of organization. And then the question, which I just heard again, is please give us the challenge. Well, the challenge is, of course, and I don't have the answer here, but I added it, is to develop strategies to complement the reductionistic approaches in science. And just saying that we should look at network levels, or just saying we should keep an eye on the holistic system, is not sufficient. I think we have to come up with a formal way to explain the appearance or the emergence of properties at higher levels of organizations. And Barabasi said we have to think in terms of networks, and we have to think in terms of hubs. But for the brain, this is not so easy. You need a really worked out system that is already very clear to be able to work like that. So I think a network approach is good, but we need much more knowledge to really apply particular network theories on brain research. And I also wonder whether networks and network thinking is the only alternative way to think in a more to explain higher level properties that arise. And I think that there is a real challenge to think about this. Yeah.
Thank you.